We have discussed multiple design considerations for thin film solar cells. In this video, we will discuss another important concept for thin film technologies, multi-junction devices. To create a good understanding of multi-junction devices, we will learn about the spectral utilization of a device with multiple junctions. We will discuss the output characteristics of such a device, and we will look at the interconnection of a multiple junction and how that affects the band diagram of the device. We will start with the spectral utilization. Shown in this figure is the AM1.5 spectral power density as observed at the surface of the Earth. As you may recall, any single junction solar cell can only utilize a fraction of the available energy as indicated by the brown area. Depending on the bandgap energy of the absorber, a fraction of the energy will be lost either due to non-absorption of the photons or due to thermalization. The spectral utilization of a single junction solar cell is described by this equation. In the denominator, the product of photon energy and photon flux is integrated over all wavelengths, effectively representing all available energy. In the numerator, the photon flux is multiplied by the bandgap energy to consider that energy above the bandgap is lost due to thermalization. Moreover, the product of the photon flux and photon energy is only integrated up to the bandgap wavelength, taking into account that photons with an energy below the bandgap are not absorbed. The usual fraction is also known as the ultimate efficiency of a single junction solar cell, as it only considers the spectral mismatch of the cell. The Shockley-Quaisel limit also considers the recombination losses that are fundamentally required since the cell temperature is above absolute zero. For a single junction solar cell with an optimal bandgap energy of 1.12 electron volts, the ultimate efficiency is about 48% and the Shockley-Quaisel limit is roughly 33%. If we introduce a second junction, the thermalization losses in the visible part of the spectrum are strongly decreased. An optimal tandem configuration has a junction with a bandgap energy of 1.74 electron volt and one with a 1.16 electron volt bandgap. The ultimate efficiency of such a tandem device is increased to over 65% and the Shockley-Quaisel limit is increased to almost 46%. If we introduce a third junction aimed at the infrared part of the spectrum, we can strongly decrease the losses due to non-absorption. An optimal triple junction device has an ultimate efficiency of 73.5% and a Shockley-Quaisel limit of over 51%. The origin of the performance increase can be visualized by this band diagram of a semiconductor. We illuminate the semiconductor with a full spectrum of photons. All photons with energies above the bandgap are able to excite electrons from the valence to the conduction band. The green and blue photons, however, are excited high into the conduction band, which means that they have a large amount of excess energy. This excess energy is lost due to thermal relaxation. Now, if we have the same incident spectrum, but with three semiconductor junctions instead of one, and with different bandgap energies, the amount of excess energy is strongly reduced. Consequently, the ultimate efficiency of the device is increased. But what does the actual performance of a multi-junction device look like? Let's look at the current voltage characteristics. This figure shows the JV curves of three single junction devices with different bandgap energies. If we integrate these three junctions into a single multi-junction device, the resulting JV curve depends on the device configurations and interconnection. The blue junction has the highest open circuit voltage and the lowest short current density, which means that this junction has the highest bandgap. In contrast, the PN junction has a low open circuit voltage and a high current density. Consequently, this junction has the lowest bandgap. The spectral part with the most energetic photons, like blue light, has the smallest penetration depth in the materials. The junction with the highest bandgap therefore always acts as the topsider. In this way, the most energetic photons are absorbed with minimal thermalization losses, and the top junction is effectively transparent to a large fraction of the spectrum with photons energies below its bandgap. Before we can draw the JV curve of the resulting triple junction cell, we must consider how the junctions are connected. We therefore look at the equivalent circuit of a semiconductor junction. As discussed in the PV energy conversion course, the photocurrent represents the photo-generated current density, while ID here represents the dark current density or saturation current density. Each junction in a multi-junction device can be represented by a single equivalent circuit. This means that the junctions could theoretically be connected in series, or they could be connected in parallel. We can gather from the figure that a parallel connection requires electrodes between each of the layers. The junctions, however, are stacked onto each other and are therefore connected in series. This means that the voltages of the individual cells add up in the triple junction cell. So, if we look at the JV curve of the triple junction device, we can see that its open circuit voltage is equal to the combined open circuit voltages of the three triple junctions. Furthermore, the current density in a series connection is the same throughout the entire solar cell, which means that the current density of the triple junction is determined by the PN junction generating the lowest current. Finally, we look at the Venn diagram of a triple junction device. The top cell with the high band gap is shown at the left-hand side, and the bottom cell is shown at the right-hand side. This Venn diagram does not represent the reality, however. If we were to place three PN junctions in series, the P layer of the top cell and the N layer of the middle cell, for instance, would form a PN junction themselves. This PN junction would operate in the reverse direction with respect to the single junction solar cells, and would therefore significantly lower the voltage of the triple junction device. To prevent this from happening, so-called tunnel junctions are included. These tunnel junctions align the valence band at one side with the conduction band at the other side of the tunnel junction. The tunnel junction has a very high bandgap energy to prevent parasitic absorption and are relatively thin with an extremely narrow depletion zone. As a result, the slopes of the valence and conduction bands are so steep that the electrons from the N layer can tunnel through the small barrier to the P layer, where they recombine with the holes. It is important that the tunnel junctions have a low resistance to minimize the voltage loss across them. In a triple junction cell, two tunnel junctions are present. The first is located between the top cell and the middle cell, and the second one between the middle and the bottom cell. Electrons and holes are generated in each of the junctions. The electrons generated in the top cell are collected at the front of the device, and the holes generated in the bottom cell are collected at the backside of the device. The holes generated in the top cell and the electrons of the middle cell recombine at the first tunnel recombination junctions. The holes of the middle cell and the electrons of the bottom cell recombine at the second tunnel junction. Indeed, in this series connected type of multi-junction solar cell, only the minority charge carriers of the top and bottom cell are used to power a load in an external circuit. These series connected multi-junction cells are also referred to as two-terminal multi-junctions and are the conventional configuration for multi-junction solar cells. At the end of this course, we will discuss the so-called four-terminal multijunctions as well, which are mainly used for hybrid multijunction concepts. In summary, we have discussed how using multiple junctions in a solar cell can increase the spectral utilization of a device by decreasing the amount of excess energy. We saw the junction with the highest bandgap energy always acts as the top cell, and that the junction in a multijunction device are connected in series. Consequently, the voltages of the individual junctions in a multijunction configuration add up, and the current of the device is limited by that of the lowest generating junction. Finally, we discussed how the multijunction devices require the use of tunnel recombination junctions. In the next section, we will look at the general processing techniques used for thin film deposition.